Okay, we're live. Good evening. My name is David Quick. I'm the Adult Services Coordinator at the DC Public Library. I'm very happy to host tonight, on behalf of the library, a conversation with Michael Jacobson about his new book, Salt Wars. We're very glad to have one of our local DC residents and friend of the library, Michael, here to talk about his work and his book. Also glad to have Laura Riley from the Washington Post here to lead our conversation tonight. We're really glad to have both of you here. A little bit of housekeeping before we begin. For those of you watching tonight, you might be watching on YouTube or Facebook. Feel free to share questions or thoughts in the comments section, and we'll see them here on this end and include them in the conversation as much as possible. I'll also put links to the book where you can check it out from the library in the chat. We definitely want you to read the book and use it from the library. And that's about it. The library is still here for you doing online conversations like this, and we want you to use our online collections and take in these events. You can find all of them at dclibrary.org. Laura, thank you again for leading the conversation. I'm going to let you take it from here.
Thanks so much, David. It's a real pleasure to be here tonight. So I will maybe go back and forth between calling you Michael and Dr. Jacobson, just to know.
Perfectly fine.
All right, great. Well, so I would love to start basically with the title of the book. And I'm so tempted with Salt Wars to make jokes about, like, the sequel is going to be Paprika Strikes Back or something like that. Kind of a double take with that. Star salt. But I would love to find out kind of from you first, what are the wars in question, and what are the major battles or skirmishes that you've kind of chronicled in this book?
Well, there are really two wars that have been going on. One is the scientific war, where there's some scientists and the bulk of the scientists who say we should cut down on salt. That'll help prevent cardiovascular disease. And a small group of other scientists, I call them the contrarians, who say that it could be dangerous to cut down on salt, that we could actually increase the risk of cardiovascular disease. And let me show you the first slide. I'll show you what these warriors look like. The fellow at the left is one of the original warriors, almost literally. His name is Walter Kempner. He's a German immigrant who went to Duke University, maybe 1939 or so, 1940. And you've heard it perhaps of the Kempner rice diet. This is the guy, Kempner. And he put people on an extremely low sodium diet. And in general, their blood pressure decreased, sometimes very, very markedly. But the diet was so tasteless that he admitted in court that he had to beat some of his patients to keep them on the diet. So that's 80 years ago. The current kind of two people who characterize the war in science, the fellow in the middle is Graham McGregor. He's English, a professor in London, and he's probably the world's leading advocate for lowering sodium intake. And he's been pretty effective, especially in England. The guy on the right is Michael Alderman. He's an American out of New York City, longtime professor, and he's one of the leaders, and he's been fairly widely quoted, especially in the New York Times, for saying cutting down on salt could be dangerous, that we should stick to what we're consuming. So those are some of the salt warriors in the science world. And enough of the slide, David. In the political world, the battles have been arisen because the general scientific consensus is we should cut down on salt. But then in comes the salt industry, the food industry, saying that can be dangerous. There's lobbying in Congress, at the FDA, and the FDA has done really very little since the first calls for reducing sodium in the food supply were made.
So before we really dive in and get at the truth of you know, what who should win this war, I would love to get a background on how you came to this as a focus. And, you know, I guess not, you know, obviously you've been involved with the Center for Science and the Public Interest for a long time, but can you kind of chronicle how this became something that you've been championing for years?
For decades, to tell you the truth. So in the 1970s, I began working on food additives and nutrition. And for the first few years, I really didn't pay much attention to salt. But then in the mid-70s, probably 1976, 77, started reading up on salt and high blood pressure, and realized that very eminent professors from around the country, around the world even, were concerned about salt. And I had one of our staff members, a young nutritionist, Bonnie Liebman, focus on this issue. And we prepared several petitions to the Food and Drug Administration saying, look, there's all this evidence that salt causes high blood pressure and hence heart disease and stroke. You got to do something about it because you're the agency in charge of keeping a safe food supply. So that's when it started. And I had no idea that this battle would go on for decades.
Well, Bonnie's still waging that battle. I know I've talked to her for stories before, and she has said, well, what about salts? You know, when talking about the dietary guidelines and things like that. So she's clearly a very devoted, you know, acolyte of yours.
Absolutely. And so we've been working on salt ever since, of petitioning the government, filing lawsuits, beating up on industry some, and trying to influence the dietary guidelines.
So I guess we should start maybe at the beginning in terms of kind of humans' affection for salt. You know, salt was this highly sought after thing, you know, historically. Why did that happen? You know, why was it so important in the human diet? Where was it from? How did we mine it? And can you give us kind of a historical perspective on how it became such a precious thing to humans?
Well, I think that people are born with a taste for salt. Our body needs salt. It's used in, you know, every cell in the body to maintain fluid balance, to balance potassium levels. It's used in muscles and nerves and everywhere. So evolution created this taste for salt, and it's really innate. And we needed that taste because salt wasn't widely available. It was available really mostly along the coastal areas, but not everywhere in the world. So it was a rare commodity. It tasted, you know, very good, and also, and I don't know when this occurred, people discovered that salt was a good preservative for meat. And so that's serving a very valuable purpose to keep a food supply, to maintain a food supply in times of shortages. But even people who didn't have any access to salt were far away from salt water, managed perfectly fine. And there are even some tribes today who have essentially a salt-free diet, no processed foods. They live in the jungles of New Guinea and South America, parts of Africa. And they consume maybe 1/20th, 1/50th as much sodium as Americans consume. You know, just remarkably low levels. And they managed, I mean, they've been reproducing for thousands of years. They're doing perfectly fine. They have no hypertension, almost no heart disease. So it's possible to live without salt, but because of the taste and the commercial functions, it became quite valuable.
So I know we're going to talk a little bit later about how much salt is in our diet, but I want to actually put a pin in something you just said, the idea that historically we've salted and preserved our food. So I want to kind of do a historical comparison of how much salt we have now versus maybe like a pioneer diet or, you know, rural Scandinavia in the 19th century or something like that, where there was a lot of like salt preserving of fish and that kind of thing. And I wonder at some point if we can kind of compare diets like that. But I think this might be a good time to talk a little bit about the benefits of sodium chloride versus potassium chloride. I think there's something you make a distinction in the book in a pretty clear way. I think a lot of people are very confused about there being a worse salt and a better salt.
Yeah.
Can you kind of unpack that a little bit?
Salt is a very generic chemical term. So table salt is sodium chloride, and there's another salt called potassium chloride. Chemically very similar, except you know half is the same, the chloride, but they're kind of opposites in the body. Potassium salt, potassium chloride, has a slightly salty taste. So it can be used to replace some salt. It can lower the sodium level in a food, and it counteracts the blood pressure raising effect of salt in the body. So it can be very useful to people who are trying to lower sodium levels. The food industry, some companies are trying to lower sodium levels, and one trick they use is to replace sodium chloride, say half the sodium chloride, with potassium chloride. And they maintain the salty taste with much less sodium. Campbell's soup is an example. It now has almost half as much salt as it did 10 years ago. Because Campbell is using potassium chloride.
Why don't more companies, is it more expensive to produce? Or why wouldn't a company, especially if we have back of the can or back of the package labeling of sodium, why wouldn't they choose to make that pivot?
Well, it's a strange situation. There's a clean label movement that doesn't want chemicals in the ingredient list. And companies are madly trying to remove the carboxymethyl cellulose and the butylated hydroxytoluene and that kind of stuff.
And they sound delicious, by the way.
Don't they? And potassium chloride sounds like a chemical to many people, whereas salt is, people are accustomed to salt. So a main reason why they're not switching is because they don't want to add potassium chloride to the label.
Does the FDA require it to be labeled as potassium chloride, whereas you can use sodium chloride and just say salt?
Yeah, that's exactly the situation. So one of the makers of potassium chloride as a replacement for sodium chloride has petitioned the Food and Drug Administration to allow potassium salt to be used as on the ingredient label. And we, the American Heart Association and others, have supported that measure. But it's also kind of a new concept. If you replace all the salt with potassium salt, it can taste disgusting. So companies have to be very careful. You know, potassium chloride by itself is very, very bitter. But if you replace half the salt, or many companies are replacing 1/4 to 1/3 of the salt, that can really help lower sodium levels. Now potassium is listed on labels. It's gaining a reputation as a good guy in the food supply. And I think we're going to see a lot more companies switching, replacing some of this salt with potassium salt.
So can you talk a little bit about how scientists discovered that excessive salt is bad for us and kind of how that played out initially?
Well, it started with clinical research, doctors having patients with high blood pressure. And I don't know how they got the idea, but it started in France in the early 1900s, about 1905. And they found that lowering sodium levels, putting their patients on a low salt diet, helped lower their blood pressure. And there was real skepticism. The Journal of the American Medical Association threw cold water on that idea. But about 20 years later, Americans did a similar study, and they found the same effect. And that gave it a little more credibility. When Walter Kempner did his studies around 1940, and then during the 1940s, that led to more careful research. And some scientists first put people on a low salt diet, which is very different from the typical American diet. It's largely rice, a little sugar, a little bit of fruit, a little bit of meat, but no grains, and hence very low in sodium. And then to some of the patients, they added salt back. And that was demonstrating that it was the salt that was certainly one of the factors in bringing down blood pressure. And then kind of the research really proliferated, but with animal studies demonstrating was very clearly that salt could raise blood pressure and lowering salt could lower blood pressure. Tribes were discovered that had very low sodium diets and very little heart disease. So that was in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, there was all this research going on. And that's what led the people at the 1969 White House Conference on Food, Nutrition, and Health to say that the food industry, starting with baby foods, should lower sodium levels. And that was kind of the first official call that I'm aware of. So it was 50 years ago. And since then, you know, we petitioned the FDA in 78. And the very next year, the FDA's own advisory committee said that salt should no longer be considered generally recognized as safe, and the FDA should take action to lower sodium levels. Well, that didn't happen really. So we go into a long history then.
Well, so I think maybe for the people who are watching this today, it would be helpful to say, why is high blood pressure bad? Why? What are the health kind of problems that ensue? And then are there other things beyond high blood pressure that a high sodium diet, other cysts, other, you know, body systems that can be affected by it?
Well, let me give a little context for sodium before we get into that. And you asked, can we go back, what were people consuming 100 years ago? And unfortunately, we can't. We don't have any records of what the average person consumed 100 years ago. We have information on foods, but not on salt. People ate a lot of preserved foods, meat and fish in particular. So we got a lot of salt there. But let me go back further. Let me go back 100,000 years, if that's going back far enough. And there were those inland tribes, some remnants of which still exist, and they were consuming something like 50 to 200 milligrams of sodium a day, 50 to 200 milligrams. The average Paleolithic diet, and those people ate meat. Those foragers consumed almost no meat. They're pretty much vegetarian. But foragers ate a much more mixed diet, and they consumed about 800 milligrams per day. The average American consumes about 3,400 milligrams a day. So vastly more than than was consumed when humans evolved. The government is recommending that we cut back by about a third to 2,300 milligrams a day, far more still than the people living in the Kalahari Desert are consuming, or those Paleolithic people, but a major reduction.
So I think you have some slides on kind of the American diet right now and sodium.
Yeah.
Kind of overt and covert sodium in our diets.
Yeah, so this shows where we're getting the sodium. And that big segment, 71% of the sodium. David, please go back. Yeah. 71%, almost 3/4 of the sodium comes from food added, from sodium added by manufacturers and restaurants. So the vast majority is out of our control.
Is this a strong should people not eat as much processed food specifically because of sodium levels?
Yeah, absolutely. That's one of the reasons. So you can buy a few processed foods that are low in sodium. If you search around in a supermarket, fresh foods have almost no sodium. Dairy foods have a little bit more. Meat has some, but we're really... only about 10% of the salt we consume comes from the salt shakers we use when we're cooking or at the table. This slide would be reversed for people in rural China and other rural low-income areas. 3/4 of the salt they consume is what they add when they're cooking, and only 10%, depending, might come from the processed foods that they're purchasing. And then when you look at some of these foods, David, the next slide, please. So keep in mind that the recommended daily intake is 2,300 milligrams. So here are some individual foods that are approaching 2,300 milligrams. It's just huge amounts of salt, partly because the portion sizes are pretty big. If you go to a restaurant on the next slide, the amount of sodium is life-threatening. Some of these meals, again, because they're so huge, contain two or three times as much sodium as is recommended for an entire day. And one of my recommendations for cutting down on sodium is to eat out less often. And I know that's not very popular, I'm sorry, but that's where so many people are getting so much sodium. If you go to a restaurant, immediately upon the food being served, put half of it aside, ask for a doggy bag for that food. So at least you're splitting it over a couple of days, or split one Bavarian Legend soft pretzel when you go back to a movie theater, split it with your whole family.
Thanks. Well, so now can we go back a little bit and talk about the health effects? I mean, this is a big downer. For some people, this may be completely common knowledge, but I have a feeling that there are some of the health effects that are less well known.
Well, the big thing is blood pressure. And there have been hundreds of studies, carefully controlled studies, that looked at different amounts of salt and blood pressure. And the more salt you consume, the higher the blood pressure goes. And then there are an equal number of studies showing that the higher the blood pressure, the more cardiovascular disease people have, particularly heart attacks and strokes. So those are really the biggest concerns. Kidney disease is a little bit behind that. But if you look at, so what are the damages? What's the magnitude of the harm? If we consumed the recommended daily amount of sodium, about 1/3 less than what we're consuming, that would save 50 to 100,000 lives a year. and tens of billion dollars in medical expenses. Just, you know, these are just enormous, enormous costs. And so we could save all those lives. So beyond that, I mentioned kidney disease, billions of dollars a year. With and then blood pressure doesn't affect just the heart and the brain with strokes or the kidneys, but other organs in the body. High blood pressure can affect the arteries in the eye, causing retinopathy, and that can lead to impaired vision or blindness. There's some recent evidence that high blood pressure is a cause of memory loss or partial memory loss, and possibly even dementia. We need more research in that area, but that's some of the good study found that.
We've all had that experience of edema, right?
That's right.
I don't know how life-threatening that is, but I think we've all experienced that. But stones, I mean, I think erectile dysfunction, there are other things that are linked to this as well.
Yeah, and then much of that's linked to blood pressure. Obesity is an unusual one because there it's kind of indirect. People on salty diets consume more liquids. And if the liquid is soda pop, that's high in sugar, and that can contribute to obesity. The problems could come out in a whole range of organs, and bloating is probably the most immediate one. Headaches, though, is another one. People on low-sodium diets have fewer headaches, not migraines, just ordinary headaches. So, you know, it goes, the effects are throughout the body. It's usually these are very subtle. You can't feel it. Edema is the one thing that is kind of pretty sudden, and you feel it, you see it. And I think it's mostly, I've never heard a man talk about that. It's usually women. So, but the subtlety and the long-term.
Our fingers, right? So we're aware of puffiness.
Yeah.
Tighter shoes.
So even though there's so much harm, it is in general long-term, slowly, gradually accumulating, and we could avoid that by starting with a low-sodium diet, ideally in childhood. You know, so we don't have to make any jarring changes when we're adults.
Well, and they talk about the first 1,000 days being the most important in terms of developing tastes and kind of predilections. And I think there's a lot of focus on sweet, but I think you're right that even with baby foods, you know, we have this idea that we want to make it palatable to us as adults. And if you remove that salt and you remove that sugar, you're giving everybody a leg up, you know, to not those tendencies.
At least for infants, the baby food companies removed the salt and the sugar 30, 40 years ago. So there's been certainly progress in that area.
The sugar's crept back in, though, with those pouches, because you can't do the retort packaging as effectively unless there's a little bit of sugar in there. So,
well, especially the toddler meals. That's when as opposed to the strained baby foods. There's very interesting research where some babies were put on a low sodium diet and others had a normal sodium diet. And the babies with these are infants. The babies with the regular sodium levels had higher blood pressure than the babies on low sodium diets. And then the researchers followed up 10 or 15 years later and discovered that a difference in blood pressure persisted over all those years. And I don't know if it's those kids had less of a taste for sodium or there was some switch in their body that protected them later. So,
all right. So I think that we can safely say that consumers are fairly confused. But what about the experts? Let's talk a little bit about what the experts say and why there hasn't been more consensus.
Yeah. Well, the Sim mentioned at the beginning, the great bulk of research has demonstrated that the more sodium people consume, the greater their blood pressure, and the higher the blood pressure, the more greater the cardiovascular disease risk is. That's kind of the establishment position based on a huge volume of research. There are a few studies that looked at the direct effect of sodium on cardiovascular disease, skipping that blood pressure tie. And these are not controlled studies, but they involve thousands or even 100,000 people. And what they found was that the people who consumed the amounts of sodium that Americans consume had the lowest risks of heart disease. When the sodium increased, that increased the rate of heart disease. But when sodium decreased, that also raised the risk of heart disease. You know, very contrary to what everybody assumed and predicted. The establishment researchers swooped in and say, that research is junk, because the sodium consumption was not measured well, let alone controlled over the course of the experiment. Typically in these studies, they measured sodium once at the very beginning of a multi-year study. And, you know, diets vary radically from day to day. And also in some of these studies, they were done in populations where in China, India, Saudi Arabia, populations very different from people living the American lifestyle. And because it wasn't controlled, people who had pre-existing disease could participate in the studies. So people who had very low sodium levels might have had heart attacks because they already had heart disease and the low sodium couldn't protect them. It was too late. So low sodium, so these studies were just flawed from the get-go. The way to measure sodium intake is to collect people's urine for 24 hours. Those studies, the contrarian studies, looked, they had people pee in a pot once in the morning, and then they used flawed mathematical formulas to convert that what's called a spot urine into these 24-hour samples. But you need to measure for 24 hours several times over the course of the experiment. And then these studies have been debunked by actual experiments to show that don't know how to explain it, but when you have some experiments had people do 24-hour collections, and they found the straight line: the more sodium, the more the greater the risk of blood pressure and heart disease. But they could also look at the only partial data from their study. And they found when they only used the first 24-hour collection of urine, then they found that U-shaped curve where the very low levels of sodium also had a higher risk of heart disease. So that the National Academy of Sciences looked at this body of research a year ago and dismissed these contrarian studies, saying they just weren't good and they've been disproven by other research.
So are these studies misinformation or disinformation? Are they funded by industry in a way to obfuscate or to push the blame for Americans' ill health onto something else? Or how do you frame it out?
Well, they weren't sponsored by industry. They were sponsored by government funding, and possibly there may be some that were funded in part by drug companies. But the food industry then took those studies and ran with them, and the anti-regulatory folks in Congress would hold up a study and saying, look, this study demonstrates that low sodium diets can be dangerous. So the food industry has really used them. And then there's some irresponsible journalists who picked up on this research and helped throw doubt on the mainstream view. And I hate to say, the Washington Post and the New York Times were among the culprits in this, among others.
It wasn't me.
No, it wasn't you. But just, I think, really irresponsible journalism, where it's an easy way to write to have a story that would attract eyeballs, saying everything you knew about salt was wrong, and then that sows such confusion that really delays things, and then it gets brought into the policy arena. People saying you need more research, you need more research, you need randomized controlled trials to demonstrate, to prove that lowering sodium is not dangerous. Those researchers don't say that it's impossible to do those studies, because you simply can't give people meals for 5 or 10 years controlling everything else in their lives. You know, people aren't going to stick with their diet. These controlled diets may last 30 days, maybe 90 days, but the National Institutes of Health, FDA, the World Health Organization, all the top researchers agree that we have enough research. We don't need more research on sodium. Planted by the food industry, but the food industry has certainly run with the ball.
Okay, well, so let's actually pivot to kind of the role of government and kind of their own culpability in kind of some of this confusion. You know, we've seen in recent years, we've seen some kind of policy changes vis-a-vis salt with the school lunch program. And in fact, today there was news on that they were once again, the Trump administration was trying to roll back the Obama era stricter sodium controls and some other things.
Right.
How has the government served us and not served us in its position, you know, vis-a-vis salt?
Well, you know, over the long term, the government has really come out on the side of voluntary action by food companies. Whenever people pushed for mandatory action, the government's knee-jerk reaction was, we'll do it on a voluntary basis. Kind of the main progress in the policy world came from nutrition labeling the nutrition labeling law in 1990 that took effect a few years later, that put sodium levels on every packaged food. So if people wanted to keep track of their sodium and look for lower sodium products, they could. So that was an advance. It didn't seem to lower sodium in the diet, though.
But don't you think that there's been, so Latin American countries have had some kind of strides in front of label warnings, you know, about things like sodium, and it's changed human behavior a little bit, but more importantly, it's made reformulations kind of more of companies, in order to not have that big ugly label on the front of their packages, have had to reformulate. Why has that not been viable here, or is not taken off to the same degree?
Well, actually, let me show you a couple of labels. Where there has been progress is in New York City and Philadelphia, not in packaged foods, but restaurants. And this is the kind of notice that appears on chain restaurant menus in Philadelphia, next to meals or individual foods that contain a huge amount of sodium, where an individual meal contains more than the recommended 2,300 milligrams per day. And New York's is similar. But to go down to Latin America, let's go to the next slide. And This is the kind of label that you see now in Chile. There are warning notice stop sign symbols if foods contain more than a given amount of, reading from the left, sugar, saturated fat, sodium, and calories. And a food that has more excessive amounts of sugar, saturated fat, and sodium has to have three stop signs on the front of the label. And that's really attention getting. And some food categories, there have been remarkable changes where companies have scrambled to avoid these labels. So with sausages, 73% had a high in sodium label before the law went into effect, and then after the labeling, it's down to 27%. So big changes. So why not? I think that's enough of the slide, David. Why not in the United States? Why not in the United States? Because of political pressure. That the food industry is very powerful, and it can stop pretty much whatever it wants to stop. Typically, by going to Congress and saying, do you see what those nutcases at the Food and Drug Administration are trying to do? They're trying to make me use less salt in my soup. And the libertarians and anti-regulatory folks in Congress say, well, that's terrible. And if you have a congressperson with a food manufacturer or a major restaurant chain in their district is very vulnerable. And they'll often succumb to that pressure. So that's the reason. It's simply bald political pressure. When you have the National Academy of Sciences saying that the United States should have those the kind of labels that are used in Chile, Uruguay, Mexico, Israel is developing a similar label, that in Canada was considering it, but they lost interest somewhere along the line, and I'm not sure if it was political pressure or what. But that kind of a label is what could change the sodium levels in the food supply. Or mandatory restrictions. So the last time the National Academy of Sciences said in 2010, you should have mandatory reductions gradually declining over a few years. The FDA said, we'll do it in a voluntary basis. In 2016, the FDA proposed voluntary limits on sodium in 158 different categories of food, very carefully defined. So that was 2016. As soon as they were proposed, the Obama administration left office, and Trump predictably did nothing for 4 years. Ironically, Trump's FDA commissioner, Scott Gottlieb, 2 years ago said, salt is the highest priority for our foods division at the FDA, and we're going to finalize these guidelines next year, which now is last year. So he wanted to do it, but he couldn't pull it off before he left.
Absolutely.
So that's where we're left, and hopefully the Biden administration will finalize those guidelines.
Yeah, he's got a lot of executive orders to undo some of the kind of food-related things that have occurred this past 4 years. So I have two kind of major questions I'd still like to ask you, and then I'd like to open it up to questions from our viewers. Viewers, if you have questions, if you can type them into that chat and we can kind of walk through those for the tail end of this program, that would be wonderful. It'd be great to hear from you all. I'm sure you have questions. So two questions that I have is kind of a little more news you can use, you know, for people, especially as we go into the holiday season. I'd like to talk a little bit about hidden salt, places that that we don't recognize as you know, hidden, you know, treasure troves of sodium. So could you talk a little bit about places that we
need to, the foods that don't taste salty?
Yeah.
So actually, the single biggest source of sodium in our diet is bread. And that's not something we perceive of as being so salty. And per serving, it doesn't have all, a slice of bread doesn't have all that much sodium, but we eat bread breakfast, lunch, and dinner. At least many of us do, and I'll speak for myself. And so in my own diet, that's a significant source. And I was surprised. I like frozen fish and shellfish. And I discovered that frozen shrimp has a huge amount of sodium. And I don't know why they add it, but it's there. It doesn't taste salty at all. And meat and poultry are often salted, containing anywhere from twice as much to 10 times as much sodium as
it. So why is that? I mean, it's diabolical, really.
It is. And it really serves two purposes. One is you can bulk up the food. When you add sodium to, when you inject or soak meat in salt water or broth, the meat will absorb more water. And the meat can end up with 25% added water. And so a meat processor can sell water at $3 a pound. So, but it also, the broth also can add flavor, keep the meat moist. So it does serve some function, but at an outrageous price. A salad dressing is often very high in sodium. Let's go to the last slide, I think, David. And this, you know, so one, I have three bits of advice for consumers. One, when you're shopping, look carefully at labels. So I won't read through all of these, but American cheese has 9 times more sodium than Swiss cheese. Get American cheese, at least some of the time. Read those meat and poultry labels carefully. Pasta sauce is something that a lot of us consume. The ragu marinara pasta sauce has 4 times more sodium than the silver palette low sodium marinara. And Consumer Reports rated that the best tasting pasta sauce. So read labels carefully. So that's rule number one. Rule two is cook from scratch more often. I know a lot of people hate to hear me say that, but that way you can control the salt and you can use half as much salt as is used in a recipe, or get some of the light salt that has half potassium salt and half sodium salt. And the third thing is eat out less often because of those salt bombs. When we've looked at restaurant meals over the years, some were high in saturated fat and some were low in saturated fat, but they were all loaded with sodium, whether it's Chinese, Greek, Italian, American, whatever. So so that's the bit of consumer advice. You can lower sodium. It isn't that hard. And if you want to take a few minutes and write a letter, tweet, or send an email to some of the food manufacturers and restaurant chains that you see using large amounts of salt, send them a note.
Wonderful. So we do have a few questions from our viewers right now, and I'd like to start with Jim Trengrove. He asks, do the effects of salt on blood pressure decrease rapidly once you stop the intake, or is it long lasting?
Well, blood pressure comes down pretty rapidly. You know, it could come down in a matter of weeks, not months or years. But the effects of that high blood pressure that you may have been experiencing for years or decades, the effects can continue for a long time. So especially stiffening of arteries, say that can be a long-term effect.
Okay. So Lisa Harris-Gore asks a couple of questions that I'll combine. So she asks, can you discuss kinds of salt, sea salt versus Himalayan salt versus kosher versus, you know, are there different kind of net health effects, one from the other? And then also, can you comment on any web stores or I guess brick and mortars that specialize in, you know, no or low sodium foods?
Well, the last thing, every supermarket, if you look carefully, you can find lower sodium foods, not necessarily really low. It depends on the food category. And I think they all sell salt substitutes. Morton has a light salt that is easy to find. And then there's herb and spice mixtures like Chef Paul Prudhomme, Chef Mrs. Dash, Chef Dash.
Wait, I thought Mrs. Dash, isn't that MSG?
No.
It's not?
Well, Mrs. Dash has all kinds of products, but there's some salt-free, sodium-free seasonings. And they don't taste like salt, but they add an interesting, different kind of a taste. Sea salt, almost all sea salt, has as much sodium as regular salt. The taste might be a teeny bit different. The appearance might be a little different. Once you put it in your food, it won't be any different and you won't taste any difference. But you can feel, I don't know, do you feel virtuous when you get sea salt? You might. It's so much more expensive, like 10 or 20 times more expensive than ordinary salt, which might come from the sea or it might come from a salt mine. Kosher salt is just ordinary salt, but it's been crystallized in a way that has hollow crystals. So a teaspoon of salt, of kosher salt, has less sodium than regular salt because the crystals are hollow. There's air there. So you can, the Harvard cafeteria system did a search and replace in all its recipes, and they replaced the word salt with diamond crystal kosher salt. And diamond crystal kosher salt is has a special configuration. It's the only brand where it has half as much sodium per teaspoon. So when they switched the recipes, they used the same number of teaspoons. They added half as much salt, sodium, and nobody complained. You know, the thousands of picky students, nobody complained.
I have to say, Ina Garten says that that is her favorite salt. That's her go-to salt. So if she says it's okay, I think we can, even the foodies amongst us can get behind that.
That's good to hear. And kosher salt can be an advantage when you're, for some foods where you salt just the outside of the food, and then the crystals can remain, they won't, they're larger, they won't quickly dissolve into the food. And so then you'll experience the salty taste more quickly. Maybe you can use less salt for that reason. And some companies are using different tricks along those lines to reduce the sodium level in the food. And so it's companies that make solid foods like salted peanuts or crackers, where the salt is on the outside. And some crackers have only one side salted, whereas they used to have two sides salted. And I should give some, you know, some companies have made an effort. The Campbell has kids' soups, and I forget what they're called, but Little Princess and I don't know, other names, that are all have less than 480 milligrams of sodium per cup. Ironically, the Campbell soups that are sold in schools, that are used by schools, have twice as much sodium. They don't use those Little Princess kind of soups. So give Campbell credit. When I was writing Salt Wars, I dug deep into my files and I found these dusty old documents from the 1970s and 80s. And I discovered that Wheat Thins now have half as much sodium as they did back then. So you can find, you know, major differences. And so Nabisco, which makes Wheat Thins, gradually reduced the sodium. Campbell gradually reduced the sodium in the tomato soup. And they're using these different tricks, different herbs and spices. In some cases, they add more real ingredients, God forbid, more vegetables to a vegetable soup. And some now are using potassium salt. So there are all these tricks. The goal of 2,300 milligrams per day, one third less, is not pie in the sky. And us consumers shouldn't wait for the government or the food industry to lower sodium in packaged and restaurant foods. We can lower sodium in our own diets beginning tonight for dinner.
Right. So I have a couple more questions. So QB asks, what was the most surprising finding that you made in doing research for this book?
I think the intensity of that debate between the scientific war between the people who said that low sodium diets are dangerous versus those who said they're safe, and the persistence of that really a baseless argument, and then how the science was dragged into the political sphere. That was kind of the crux of this area of political science, politics.
So Roberta Baskin asks, if you have low blood pressure, which I do,
Well, there's always some woman in the audience, Roberta and Laura, who says, my blood pressure is 90 over 50. I'm practically fainting. Do I have to cut down on salt? And no, you don't. That's one, and you could talk to your doctor about that. But, you know, you shouldn't worry. But if you're 20 years old or 40 years old and you have normal blood pressure, you should realize that Americans' blood pressure rises gradually over the years because of salt and other factors, and that 80 or 90% of us end up with high blood pressure by the time we're 70 or 80 years old. So a lower sodium diet should be the default. People shouldn't have to make a huge effort to ferret out those few low sodium foods at the grocery store. And then we could take advantage of more prepared foods. Low sodium foods should be the norm.
Wonderful. Well, this has been a wonderful hour. It's gone by super swiftly, as we kind of knew it would. There's a lot more to cover. I'd like to actually just put the book up here. You can buy it at all your wherever you buy books, or online.
Or the library.
Go to the library. We were talking about the wonderful benefits of the library during the pandemic. But thank you all for coming tonight. And thanks, David, for making this happen. And Dr. Jacobson, this has been a wonderful and edifying bit of time with you. So thanks for doing this.
Thank you so much, Laura. And thank you for doing it. And thank you, David, for hosting this great event.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.